The Phoenix program, created by the CIA in 1967, was aimed at neutralizing through assassination, kidnapping, and torture the civilian infrastructure that supported the Viet Cong insurgency in South Vietnam. It was a terrifying final solution that violated the Geneva Conventions. The Phoenix program's civilian targets of assassination were Viet Cong tax collectors, supply officers, political cadre, local military officials, and suspected sympathizers. Faulty intelligence often led to the murder of innocent civilians. Rival Vietnamese would report their enemies as VC in order for U.S. troops to kill them. In 1971, William Colby, head of the CIA in Vietnam, testified the number killed was 20,000. South Vietnamese government figures were 40,000 dead. CIA officer Ted Shackley managed 600 military and 50 CIA liaison officers who were working with South Vietnamese officers in 44 provinces. Ted Shackley and Robert Comer played key roles in recruiting Phoenix program personnel. Many covert action officers were Cuban refugees from the Bay of Pigs fiasco. They ran the CIA's counter-terror teams, which were in fact assassination squads. Colby, Comer, and Shackley reported to the Director of Central Intelligence, Richard Helms, and the White House. From the beginning, the Phoenix program was conceived by the White House and supported by the CIA. Phoenix called for neutralizing 1,800 targets a month. About one-third of VC targeted for arrest were summarily executed. Green Berets and Navy SEALs would assassinate suspected VC sympathizers or cadre, as well as South Vietnamese collaborators and double agents. In 1982, an ex-Phoenix operative revealed that sometimes orders were given to kill U.S. military personnel who were considered security risks. He suspects the orders came not from division, but from a higher authority, such as the CIA or the Office of Naval Intelligence. The following testimony of Vincent Okamoto, combat officer, lieutenant in Vietnam in 1968, and recipient of the Distinguished Service Cross, the second highest award conferred by the U.S. Army, wounded three times. Quote, "The problem was, how do you find the people on the blacklist? It's not like you had their address and telephone number. The normal procedure would be to go into a village and just grab someone and say, 'Where's Wynn so-and-so?' Half the time, the people were so afraid they would say anything. Then a Phoenix team would take the informant, put a sandbag over his head, poke out two holes so he could see, put coma wire around his neck like a long leash, and walk him through the village and say, 'When we go by Wynn's house, scratch your head.' Then, that night, Phoenix would come back, knock on the door, and say, 'April Fool, motherfucker.' Whoever answered the door would get wasted. As far as they were concerned, whoever answered was a communist, including family members. Sometimes they'd come back to camp with ears to prove that they killed people." Penetrations into the Viet Cong infrastructure were accomplished by blackmailing or terrorizing a member of a targeted individual's family to gather information. Every Vietnamese 15 and over had to register and carry an identity card. These records were computerized and evolved into a highly computerized and statistical means of generating 1,800 names a month for the target list and coordinating this information on suspects from 30,000 plus informants. When the Strategic Hamlet program failed, CIA and military intelligence concentrated on the Phoenix program, a terror campaign aimed at the civilian population. Instead of winning hearts and minds, using the threat of assassination and a state of terror to defeat the North Vietnamese. Many non-political Vietnamese were arrested and tortured and in effect forced into the resistance army. Phoenix program architect Robert Comer, after leaving the Pentagon, said, quote, "I would have done a lot of things differently and been more cautious about getting us involved." He called the war a strategic disaster which cost us 57,000 lives and $500 billion. The Vietnam War was the formative experience for a generation of CIA and military intelligence personnel involved in the Phoenix program. They viewed the military defeat in Vietnam as a betrayal on the home front, a loss of will by domestic political enemies, not a military failure against a nationalistic revolution fought as a guerrilla war. The Phoenix program, assassinating suspected VC sympathizers in a systematic manner, worked well and is the blueprint for the current black operation targeting thousands of loyal Americans using state-of-the-art microwave and radio frequency radiation weapons. The motivation to suppress domestic dissidents and to assassinate loyal American opposition stems from the perception of dissent against the war as treason. This philosophy is stated very clearly in the Mind War paper written by NSA General Michael Aquino. The Department of Defense has a huge stake in futuristic technology that kills by ionizing and non-ionizing radiation, leaving little or no trace. The indiscriminate killing of the Phoenix program continues on American soil. The terms soft kill, slow kill, and silent kill refer to the new way of killing the enemy in conflicts short of war and the small wars of the future. The counterinsurgency doctrine has now been applied to the home front so that the perceived betrayal of the military in Vietnam will not be repeated. The generation of CIA and military intelligence led by Shackley, Helms, Casey, Singlab, Secord, John B. Alexander, Michael Aquino, Paul Vallely, and others have built the perfect beast using selective assassination that leaves no trace. The ability to cull the human herd with silent kill technology allows a few personalities to remake the entire society in their own image. Extremely low frequency technology slowly drives the target crazy with silent sound, similar to the CIA MKUltra psychiatrist Ewan Cameron's psychic driving technique used to break down the target's personality. The new buzzwords at the Pentagon are synthetic telepathy and psychotronics. Another means of attack on targets is the Smirnov patent that uses subliminal suggestion to manipulate human behavior. This patent was purchased by the remote viewing company SciTech Corporation. Military intelligence officers involved in developing these non-lethal weapons include Alexander, Aquino, Putoff, and others, also control SciTech. Emotional manipulation is accomplished using Dr. Michael Persinger's work to remotely project emotional states that the brain entrains or locks onto and emulates. One can broadcast rage or fear at an individual target to manipulate and control them. As if these methods were not enough to torture and murder people, add to this nightmarish toolbox active gang stalking. CIA-created cults and other cause-oriented groups are used to induce further trauma in the target by actively harassing them in public in a neutralization technique described in counterintelligence operations manuals that are aimed at enemy agents. In the race to develop a new weapon, it has always been necessary to test it on human beings. Perfecting the latest weapons designed to kill slowly and silently, as well as perfecting the process of controlling the human mind, are no different. Once the weaponry has been perfected on these few thousand people, the same techniques will be applied en masse to the general population and then to humanity as a whole. To understand the new Phoenix program, it is necessary to begin at the beginning of U.S. government human experimentation, the Manhattan Project. At dawn on July 16, 1945, the Trinity site witnessed the detonation of the device codenamed Gadget. The remaining two devices, named Little Boy and Fat Man, were used on Hiroshima and Nagasaki on August 6th and 9th, killing approximately 200,000 people.
World War II terror bombing of civilians began with the London Blitz, killing 30,000 people, and culminated in the firebombing of Dresden, Germany, and Tokyo. Napalm was used in 1,000 plane raids that incinerated approximately 200,000 people. The atomic bomb did not add to the scale of mass murder of civilian populations, but it certainly made it more efficient. Many of the scientists were appalled at the result. Some had urged a demonstration shot. The scientists declared publicly that the U.S. possessed only a few years' head start before another nation followed suit. Many of the scientists and some generals advocated international control and the eventual banning of nuclear weapons. Those that tried to head off a nuclear arms race in the end failed, as events and personalities took on a momentum of their own. Edward Teller advocated the super heavy, the hydrogen bomb. Oppenheimer objected to the development of the hydrogen bomb and stated that these were genocidal weapons. He was promptly replaced. Teller assumed the scientific leadership of the weapons program and remained influential for the entire Cold War. The largest hydrogen bomb ever tested by the U.S. was around 40 megatons, 2,000 times more powerful than the 20-kiloton Hiroshima bomb. The nuclear arms race that followed has resulted in the doctrine of MAD, mutually assured destruction. If either the U.S. or USSR launched any or all of their half of the 20,000 nuclear weapons they have aimed at each other, then they can rest assured that they too would be completely destroyed in a retaliatory strike. The nuclear arms race consumed much of the wealth of the U.S., leaving the civilian population living in the very real fear that the world could end in a matter of minutes. In 1943, the first human test subjects would be used without their knowledge or consent. American citizens and hospitals began to receive plutonium or other forms of radiation treatments that had no therapeutic value. All of the experiments were conducted for the express purpose of answering the unknowns. How much radiation could kill a man? Could blood tests detect exposure? Are there treatments for exposure? Long before radiological warfare was used on enemy populations in war, it was purposely tested on American civilians. By 1945, the war was over, but these questions remained unanswered, and the experiments would continue in secret for the next 30 years. The School of Aviation Medicine in San Antonio, Texas, quietly began to do the test for the Air Force. Military officials did not object to the use of cancer patients, but many of these people were not very ill or had been misdiagnosed. Several of the people injected with plutonium had been diagnosed as having cancer when they did not. Many of the others were not cancer patients, but suffered from illnesses such as hemophilia, scleroderma, or Cushing's disease. These errors were repeated in the total body irradiation experiments that were sponsored by the military. Many of the cancer patients had been well enough to work and live normally. A lethal dose of radiation is 350 rad. After doses of 100 to 2,000 rad, many patients died within days or weeks from radiation poisoning. Those that lived were often debilitated and in constant pain. Nazi scientists were employed at Randolph Air Force Base in San Antonio and involved in these lethal experiments. These were just a few of the thousands of Nazi scientists who had secretly been smuggled into the U.S. under Operation Paperclip to help the U.S. destroy the USSR. Dr. Hubertus Strughold was their intellectual and spiritual leader in radiation studies. He brought in Dr. Herbert Gerstner, who used prisoners during the war to study at what point human hearing is completely destroyed due to shelling, and to study the exact cause of death in cases of electrocution. These men had all experimented on prisoners in concentration camps, and were now in San Antonio doing lethal radiation experiments on American citizens for the military. Elmer Allen was designated experimental test subject Cal 13. On July 18, 1947, in a San Francisco hospital, he was injected with plutonium in the left leg. 3 days later, the leg was amputated at mid-thigh. Elmer was a porter for the Pullman Company who injured his leg while stepping off a train. He was diagnosed with a fracture that developed into a cyst. The first test for cancer was negative. A second test indicated cancer. Unable to work after the amputation, He was forced to return to Italy, Texas, with his wife and three children. His wife recalled that he began having epileptic seizures. Quote, he would chew through the spoon, his tongue, too. Elmer began drinking heavily and told his best friend that he had been used as a guinea pig, but no one, not even his family doctor, believed him. The doctor later diagnosed him as a paranoid schizophrenic. During an effort to collect the bodies of the people injected with plutonium, it was discovered to their amazement that four of them were still alive. 1 year after Elmer's death, the family was contacted by a reporter and learned that Elmer had been a human experimental subject, and the family had been lied to for 44 years. Elmer Allen died in 1991. His headstone reads, Elmer Allen, 1911-1947, Cal 13, 1947-1991, one of America's nuclear guinea pigs.
I hope you will understand that just as Jewish fathers were placed in the ovens at Auschwitz, my father, Elmer Allen, was placed in his own private oven here in the United States of America. He was left there for 44 years, and the scientist occasionally took a peek inside to see if he was still alive. His survivors are pledged to tell the truth about this experiment for the next 50 or even 100 years if necessary, so that future generations will have more than lies, half-truths, and inconclusive reports when attempting to recount this real-life horror story.
While secret radiation experiments on thousands of Americans were going on in hospitals, the very public testing of nuclear weapons lasted from 1945 until the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty in 1963. Approximately 253 above-ground tests were conducted in the Pacific and continental United States, in which 200,000 military personnel took part. The atomic veterans issued the following statement. We were the victims of radiation experiments, too. They exposed over 200,000 of us in over 200 atmospheric atomic and hydrogen bomb tests between 1945 and 1962. They deliberately bombed us with nuclear weapons and exposed us to deadly radioactivity to see how it would affect us and our equipment in nuclear warfare on land, sea, and air. They didn't need our informed consent because we were under military discipline. They devalued our lives too. They made us sterile. They crippled and killed our children. They made widows of our wives. Then denied repeatedly and publicly that there was ever any danger. Say the lie often enough and people will believe it.
Of your company?
Yes, sir, that's right.
How many of your men do you think would volunteer to go up and be in one of those foxholes when the bomb went off?
Oh, I'd volunteer, I guess, of about a half a dozen.
At least half a dozen?
Yes, sir.
You know, that's quite a loud noise that bomb makes when it goes off. Do you think it would do any harm?
No, I don't think the noise would, no.
How about radiation? Do you think there's much danger from radiation?
Well, radiation is the least of the worries that the men are thinking about.
I think most people thought that radiation was the greatest danger, didn't they? What did they learn different?
We were, prior to our instructions here, we received a very thorough briefing before we even came into close to contact with it.
A third group of experimental human subjects, besides the radiation experiment victims and the atomic veterans, are the downwinders. This term refers to all the people exposed to radiation as a result of atmospheric testing. This group, in essence, comprises the entire United States and, in fact, the entire world. Fallout from all 2,000 nuclear tests has deposited plutonium, strontium-90, and other radioactive substances in the bodies of every human being on Earth. At what point this experiment would prove fatal for all human life is unknown, but it is known that the human embryo is very vulnerable, and that 1 to 2 rads is sufficient to produce deformity or death. This much radiation and more has been deposited across the continental United States. Several studies document an unexplained increase in child mortality in the U.S. that began shortly after testing began and decreased after atmospheric testing ended. The government held hearings in the 1990s and gave monetary compensation to some individuals injected with plutonium, but not the thousands of others injured in secret testing. The government's report is largely a whitewash. Few victims were compensated, and no scientist or government employee was ever punished. The institutions involved all claimed ignorance or that the patients were fully informed, which was patently false in all cases. They have largely dodged their responsibility for participating in these acts, the same acts for which the Allies hung Nazi war criminals. After the 1995 Presidential Advisory Committee on Human Radiation Experiments submitted its final report, the children of the deceased plutonium victims had the following statements. Quote, "I guess the government really won. All the culprits that planned and executed this thing got away with it." For them to say that a little apology is enough is just beyond belief. "I do feel betrayed, and I feel abused by this committee's report." Unquote. Nuclear explosions produce plutonium oxide, which is deposited in the lungs and lymph nodes and cannot be detected in the urine. The human experimental subjects were injected with a different form, plutonium citrate or plutonium nitrate, which does show up in the urine. 30 years of testing urine from those exposed in above-ground nuclear tests has led to thousands of tests that show a false negative, meaning that the tests were scientifically useless. It had all been for nothing. Mary Jean Connell, the only living victim of the plutonium experiments, when asked how she felt after receiving $100,000, merely replied, "I'm afraid it's going to happen again, you know." MKUltra was the secret CIA crash program to develop techniques to control the human mind. By the end of the Korean War, 70% of the 7,000 U.S. prisoners of war had signed confessions, 15% cooperated fully, and only 5% steadfastly refused confession or indoctrination. Professors Wolf and Hinkle submitted a secret report to Director of Central Intelligence Alan Dulles about communist methods of brainwashing that was the definitive work on the subject in 1953. It stated that no drugs or machines were used. Intense psychological pressure and human weakness were the key, beginning with solitary confinement. Guards constantly reminded the prisoner that he was totally cut off from outside support, ordered him to stand for long periods, dictated the positions allowed for sleep, waking him if he moved while sleeping, banned all outside stimuli such as books, conversation, or news of the outside world. After 4 to 6 weeks, the prisoner would break down. Quote, "He weeps, he mutters, and prays aloud in his cell." At this stage, the interrogation began in a special room. The guard told him that he knew his own crimes all too well. The prisoner is in the position of trying to prove his innocence to he knew not what. The interrogator and the prisoner bond in their shared ransacking of the captive's soul. As the interrogation proceeded, the prisoner realized that he could only end his ordeal with a full confession. Quote, "The prisoner feels that something must be done to end this. He must find a way out." According to a KGB man, more than 99% of prisoners sign a confession at this stage. Then the subject was either shot or sent to a labor camp after sentencing. Chinese techniques would move on to re-education of prisoners by moving them into a group cell for political indoctrination. Incessant study of Marx and Mao, lectures, and self-criticism led to political conversion by group pressure. Prisoners demonstrated their commitment by ferociously attacking any deviations. Constant intimacy with prisoners who reviled him for his resistance pushed the prisoner beyond his emotional endurance. As the prisoner conformed, his cellmates gave increased acceptance and esteem, which reinforced his commitment to the party, for he learned that only his acceptance allowed him to live successfully in the cell. In contrast, the American mind control effort was a mini Manhattan Project, with the conviction that the keys to brainwashing lay in technology. The agency's brainwashing experts gravitated to people in the mold of the brilliant and sometimes mad scientists, obsessed by the wonders of the brain. In 1953, CIA officer Richard Helms chose Dr. Sidney Gottlieb to run the technical service staff. The TSS, through the Office of Research and Development, was given the job of developing poisons to assassinate political opponents, truth serum drugs for interrogating spies, and hypnotic techniques to create unwitting double agents, couriers, and robot assassins. Dr. Gottlieb used Nazi scientists and their state-of-the-art mind-control techniques that had been perfected in concentration camps using victims of the Holocaust. General Dwight D. Eisenhower gave his personal approval to exploit the work and research of the Nazis in the death camps. The German doctors were brought to the U.S. and went to work for Project Paperclip. These men were insulated against war crimes charges. The Nuremberg prosecutors were shocked that the U.S. authorities were using German doctors despite their criminal past. Under the leadership of Dr. Strughold, 34 scientists accepted contracts from Project Paperclip and were moved to Randolph Air Force Base in San Antonio, Texas. These personalities began to work on human radiation studies, aviation medicine, microwave technology, and MK-Ultra mind control experiments. The authorization to hire these Nazi scientists came directly from the Joint Chiefs of Staff. The top military brass stated that they wished to exploit these rare minds. Operation Paperclip eventually recruited 9,000 Nazi scientists and technicians to help the U.S. destroy the USSR. Some of these scientists were known as programmers, people skilled in the art of breaking down and controlling the human mind. Dr. Joseph Mengele and others experimented extensively with children and adults using mescaline, electroshock therapy, hypnosis, sensory deprivation, torture, rape, starvation, and trauma bonding in an effort to control the human mind. Dr. Mengele was so successful using the technique of trauma bonding that survivors today still exhibit a profound affection for their torturer, referring to Mengele as Beautiful Joseph. Dr. L. Wilson Green was a Jewish doctor who the Nazis coerced to participate in their experiments at Auschwitz. This individual, whose code name was Dr. Green, came to the U.S. after World War II and began to experiment on adults and children for the military and CIA. The military and CIA copied the Nazi methodology and began numerous programs of their own. The first CIA program was known as MKUltra. The MK is an abbreviation for the German words for mind control. By 1953, the CIA, U.S. Navy, and U.S. Army Chemical Corps were conducting their own narco-hypnosis programs on prisoners, mental patients, foreigners, ethnic minorities, and those classified as sexual deviants. To avoid confusion, the dozens of mind control operations will be referred to generically as MKUltra. According to MKUltra documents and sources, the methodology of mind control works best when severe trauma is administered by the age of 3 years old. Severe trauma, such as rape, applied at the age of 3, will cause the personality to split or dissociate in an attempt to shield the mind from memories of events too painful to endure. The psychiatric terms are multiple personality disorder or dissociative identity disorder and can be produced accidentally or purposefully. The Three Faces of Eve is the true story of multiple personality disorder created by childhood abuse. Psychic trauma and creation of multiple personalities was eventually codified by programmers into a standard methodology and is typically accomplished by forcing children to observe and participate in the ritual sacrifice of animals and humans, and inducing further psychic trauma by the means of rape and other horrors. The trauma causes the dissociation. This functions much like the partitioning of a hard drive in a computer. The dissociative state is used as an opening to hypnotically induce an alternate shell personality. The programmer will use hypnosis and triggers to call forth the created personality, known as an alter personality. Only 20% of the general population is easily hypnotizable, but trauma at an early age makes people vulnerable to dissociation and thus easily hypnotizable. Typically, the programmer might wear a costume, such as a rabbit suit, and sacrifice a rabbit in front of the child victims before they are physically traumatized. The image of the rabbit, a phrase from Alice in Wonderland, or similar paired images are used as the triggers to call forth the alter personality. The method works best when the trauma is repeated around 6 years of age. A few years later, the child victim's IQ test and personality test are evaluated to determine whether the child may be trained in assassination, sexual blackmail, drug courier, or other role. The subject can be hypnotized and used for operations, but would only be consciously aware of the sense of lost time. Dr. Sidney Gottlieb employed these early programmers and concentrated on the use of LSD for mind control and exotic poisons and drugs for political assassinations. He personally gave LSD to an unknowing fellow scientist, Dr. Frank Olson, who worked for the Army Chemical Corps Special Operations Division at Fort Detrick. His job was developing biological weapons. Dr. Olson committed suicide by jumping through the window of a 10th-floor hotel. Dr. Gottlieb concealed his actions, and the Olson family was unaware of the cause of his suicide until 27 years later, when the facts emerged during a congressional hearing on CIA abuses. The link between Gottlieb and Olson illustrates how the different elements of biological and chemical weapons, radiation testing, and MKUltra were all intertwined. Dr. Ewan Cameron was president of the American and Canadian Psychiatric Associations. He ran the Allen Memorial Institute, which was founded in 1943 with funds from the Rockefeller Foundation. Nazi paperclip scientists made their way into the CIA and military-sponsored mind control programs here in the United States and Canada. Some of these scientists were friends of Dr. Cameron. Money for Cameron's operation came from the CIA and was funneled through the Cornell Society for the Investigation of Human Ecology. The systematic annihilation or depatterning of a subject's mind and memory was accomplished with overdoses of LSD, barbiturate sleep for 65 days at a time, and electroshock therapy at 75 times the recommended dosage. Psychic driving, the repetition of a recorded message for 24 hours a day, programmed the emptied mind. The Canadian government settled a class action lawsuit by 250 former patients of Dr. Cameron decades later, but no person or institution has ever been disciplined or punished for these activities. Linda McDonald was 25 years old in 1963 when Dr. Cameron treated her for mild postpartum depression. She received 102 electroshock therapy treatments, 80 days of drug-induced sleep, and emerged completely depatterned, essentially like a newborn, totally incontinent, unable to state her name or recognize her husband and children. She had to relearn how to drive, cook, read, and use a toilet. Eventually, unlike many of the patients of Dr. Cameron, she made a complete recovery. Cameron was the premier psychiatrist of the 20th century. He had studied Nazi scientists at the Nuremberg trials and later replicated many of their methods and sought their assistance in the race to control the human mind. Cameron's mind control experiments were one program out of many run by the CIA, Navy, Air Force, Army, and others. Although many parallel operations were occurring in the U.S., none of them was ever discovered or prosecuted. These programs were run by men of the likes of Morse Allen, Dr. L. Wilson Green, Dr. Martin Orne, Dr. Stephen Aldrich, Dr. James Hamilton. These and other American and foreign-born programmers were supervised by Dr. Sidney Gottlieb, who was in turn supervised by Richard Helms and Alan Dulles, the director of the Central Intelligence Agency.
I was tired, I was depressed, my back was hurting. And so he said to the children's father, why don't you go to Montreal and visit this Dr. Ewan Cameron, this famous man who has all of these accolades, and have an assessment. So we went. My medical file even says that I took my guitar with me. And that was the end of my life. Within 3 weeks, Dr. Cameron decided to call me an acute schizophrenic and ship me up to the sleep room. I was in a coma for 86 days.
86 days of unbroken sleep. Yeah.
Total comatose state. I was had to be toilet trained. I was a vegetable. I had no identity. I had no memory. I'd never existed in the world before. Like a baby. Just like a baby that has to be toilet trained. Pictures, and I know who that is, who they are, but I don't remember them as my children at all. Hmm. I mean, I know that they came from my body, but there's no... that's all. I don't know, and that's because I was told that.
Hmm.
So these are my children.
Linda McDonald would hound the federal government for 4 years before finally in 1992... Ottawa grudgingly agreed to compensate her and some of Dr. Cameron's other victims, $100,000 each.
Richard Helms ran the Dirty Tricks Department after the Bay of Pigs and became director of Central Intelligence in 1966. He destroyed the archive on MKUltra when he left in 1972 and successfully covered up the crimes of MKUltra. Helms was a product of the Eastern establishment. His grandfather was president of the Federal Reserve. Helms, like Gottlieb, was a Machiavellian character who used paperclip scientists and would stop at nothing to win. He advocated low-intensity warfare, transmitting strategic subliminal messages to the brains of enemy populations and the use of high frequencies to affect memory and the unconscious mind. In 1964, he wrote a memo to the Warren Commission where he mentions biological radio communication. quote, "Cybernetics can be used in molding of a child's character, the inculcation of knowledge and techniques, the amassing of experience, the establishment of social behavior patterns, all functions which can be summarized as control of the growth processes of the individual." In 1953, MKUltra relied on LSD, but by the 1960s the emphasis had changed to biological radio communication. MKUltra had 149 sub-projects that encompassed nearly every aspect of human behavior and social science. In the 1977 Senate hearings, former CIA Director Admiral Stansfield Turner stated that the program took place at 80 institutions, including 44 universities, 15 private companies, 12 hospitals, and 3 prisons. MKUltra Subproject 119 was the foundation of all non-lethal weapons programs currently active and included a summary of 5 areas, one of which is entitled Techniques of Activation of the Human Organism by Remote Electronic Means. This memo was dated August 17, 1960, and when viewed with other evidence that was not destroyed, shows significant interest in radio frequency weapons and direct control of human behavior at a distance. By 1960, the CIA dropped emphasis on the use of LSD in favor of electronic influence. This aspect of the research is where the greatest modern emphasis has been, rather than chemical or biological agents, both of which violate existing treaties and leave physical traces. Dr. Stephen Aldrich took control of the Office of Research and Development in 1962 from Dr. Sidney Gottlieb. Aldrich started Operation Often, an investigation into the occult with the help of Houston sorceress Sybil Leek. CIA behaviorists carefully studied every aspect of the occult underground. The Scientific Engineering Institute, SEI, was a CIA cutout that had been set up in 1956 to study radar. In 1962, SEI set up a lab to study the effects of electrodes deep in the brain. In 1972, SEI also sponsored a course at the University of South Carolina in Rituals of Demonology and Voodoo. Dr. Aldrich was an MKUltra programmer who focused on remote brain manipulation and the occult, the twin threads that run through SEI Corporation. In 1962, a CIA manual focused on radiohypnotic intracerebral control, RHIC, which was developed by the Pentagon, quote, "When a part of your brain receives a tiny electrical impulse from outside sources, such as vision, hearing, etc., an emotion is produced, anger at the sight of a gang of boys beating an old woman, for example. The same emotions of anger can be created by artificial radio signals sent to your brain by a controller. You could instantly feel the same white-hot anger without any apparent reason." Unquote. Another term, electronic dissolution of memory, EDOM, refers to the ability to erase memory at a distance.
I'm Chris DiNicola, born July of 1962, rendering me 32 years of age. I was a subject in radiation as well as mind control and drug experiments performed by a man I knew as Dr. Green. I was a subject from 1966 to 1976. Dr. Green performed radiation experiments on me in 1970, focusing on my neck, throat, and chest, 1972 focusing on my chest and my uterus in 1975. Each time I became dizzy, nauseous, and threw up. All these experiments were performed on me in conjunction with mind control techniques and drugs in Tucson, Arizona. Dr. Green was using me mostly as a mind control subject from 1966 to 1973. His objective was to gain control of my mind and train me to be a spy assassin. I was in what looked like a laboratory, and there seemed to be other children. I was strapped down, naked, spread eagle, on a table, on my back. Dr. Green had electrodes on my body, including my head. He used what looked like an overhead projector and repeatedly said he was burning different images into my brain while a red light flashed aimed at my forehead. In between each sequence, he used electric shock on my body and told me to go deeper and deeper, while repeating each image would go deeper into my brain, and I would do whatever he told me to do. I felt drugged because he had given me a shot before he started the procedure. When it was over, he gave me another shot. The next thing I remember, I was with my grandparents again in Tucson, Arizona. I was 4 years old. You can see from this experiment that Dr. Green used trauma, drugs, post-hypnotic suggestion, and more trauma in an effort to gain total control of my mind. He used me in radiation experiments both for the purposes of determining the effects of radiation on various parts of my body and to terrorize me as an additional trauma in the mind control experiments. The rest of the experiments took place in Tucson, Arizona, out in the desert. I was taught how to pick locks, be secretive, use my photographic memory, and a technique to withhold information by repeating numbers to myself. Dr. Green moved on to wanting me to kill dolls that looked like real children. I stabbed a doll with a spear once after being severely traumatized, but the next time I refused. He used many pain induction techniques, but as I got older, I resisted more and more. He often tied me down in a cage, which was near his office. Between 1972 and 1976, he and his assistants were sometimes careless and left the cage unlocked. Whenever physically possible, I snuck into his office and found files with reports and memos addressed to CIA and military personnel. Included in these files were project, subject, and experiment names with some code numbers for radiation and mind control experiments, which I have submitted in your written documentation. I was caught twice, and Dr. Green ruthlessly used electric shock, drugs, spun me on a table, put shots in my stomach, in my back, dislocated my joints, and hypnotic techniques to make me feel crazy and suicidal. Because of my rebellion and growing lack of cooperation, they gave up on me as a spy assassin. Consequently, the last 2 years, 1974 to 1976, Dr. Green used various mind control techniques to reverse the spy assassin messages to self-destruct and death messages. His purpose? He wanted me dead, and I struggled to stay alive all of my adult life. I believe it is by the grace of God that I am still alive. These horrible experiments have profoundly affected my life. I developed multiple personality disorder because Dr. Green's goal was to split my mind into as many parts as possible so he could control me totally. He failed, but I've had to endure years of constant physical, mental, and emotional pain even to this day.
Between the years of 1957 and 1984, I became a pawn in a government scheme. His ultimate goal was mind control and to create the perfect spy, all through the use of chemicals, radiation, drugs, hypnosis, electric shock, isolation in tubs of water, sleep deprivation, brainwashing, verbal, physical, emotional, and sexual abuse. I was exploited unwitteringly for nearly three decades of my life. And the only explanations given to me were that, quote, the end justifies the means, and, quote, I was serving my country in their bold effort to fight communism. I can only summarize my circumstances by saying they took an already abused 7-year-old child and compounded my suffering beyond belief. The saddest part is I know for a fact that I was not alone. There were countless other children in my same situation, and there was no one to help us. until now. Dr. L. Wilson Green, who claimed to have received $50 million from the Edgewood Chemical and Radiology Laboratory as part of the TSD, or Technical Science Division, of the CIA, once described to Dr. Charles Brown that, quote, children were used as subjects because they were more fun to work with and cheaper, too. They needed lower profile subjects than soldiers or government people, so only young, willing females would do. Besides, he said, I like scaring them. They in the agency think I'm a god, creating subjects, experiments for whatever deviant purposes Sid and James can think up. Sid being Dr. Sidney Gottlieb, James, Dr. James Hamilton. In 1958, I was to be tested, they told me, by some important doctors from the Society, or the Human Ecology Society, and I was instructed to cooperate. I was told not to look at anyone's faces and not try hard not to ignore, to try hard not to ignore any names, as this was a very secret project. But I was told to be brave, and all these things would help me forget. Naturally, as most children do, I did the opposite and remembered as much as I could. Dr. John Gittinger tested me, Dr. Cameron gave me the shocks, and Dr. Green the x-rays. Then I was told by Sid Gottlieb that, quote, I was right for the big A, or meaning artichoke. By the time I left to go home, just like every time from then on, I would remember only whatever explanations Dr. Robert G. Heath of Tulane Medical University gave me for the odd bruises, needle marks, burns on my head, fingers, and even the genital soreness. I had no reason to believe otherwise. They had already begun to control my mind. The next year, I was sent to a lodge in Maryland called Deep Creek Cabins to learn how to sexually please men. I was taught how to coerce them into talking about themselves, and it was Richard Helms, who was deputy director of the CIA, Dr. Gottlieb, Captain George White, Morris Allen, who all planned on filming as many high government agency officials and heads of academic institutions and foundations as possible, so that later when the funding for mind control and radiation started to dwindle, projects would continue. I was used to entrap many unwitting men, including themselves, all with the use of a hidden camera. I was only 9 years old when this sexual humiliation began. I overheard conversations about a part of the agency called ORD, which I found out was Office of Research and Development. It was run by Dr. Green, Dr. Stephen Aldrich, Martin Oren, and Morris Allen. Once a crude remark was made by Dr. Gottlieb about a certain possible leak over New Orleans East involving a large group of retarded children who are being given massive doses of radiation. He asked, why was Wilson so worried about a few retarded kids? After all, they would be the least likely to spill the beans. Another time, I heard Dr. Martin Oren, who was the director then of the scientific office and later the head of the Institute for Experimental Research, state that, quote, in order to keep more funding coming from different sources for radiation and mind control projects, he suggested stepping up the amounts of stressors used and also the blackmail portion of the experiments. He said it needed to be done faster than to get rid of the subjects, or they were asking for us to come back later and haunt them with our remembrances. I've already submitted as much information as possible, including conversations overheard of the people, agencies responsible. I'm able to report all this to you in such detail because of my photographic memory and the arrogance of the doctors, the arrogance of the people involved. They were certain they would always control my mind. Although the process of recalling these atrocities is not an easy one, nor is it without some danger to myself and my family, I feel the risk is worth taking.
Project Pandora. In 1953, the Russians began to bombard the U.S. Embassy in Moscow with electromagnetic radiation in the microwave spectrum, but the fact was kept secret from the embassy employees. U.S. Ambassador Stossel contracted a blood disease, bleeding eyes, nausea, and eventually lymphoma. He and other employees eventually died as a result of the microwave attacks. Dr. Henry Kissinger sent a secret memo giving hazard pay to embassy personnel in the 1970s. Before the attacks, the USSR had met with the U.S. to try to head off an arms race in electromagnetic weapons, but were refused. In retaliation, they began microwaving the U.S. Embassy. It is possible that the U.S. government took advantage of the situation and used the embassy staff as microwave guinea pigs. The Department of Defense's Advanced Research Projects Agency, ARPA, set up a lab at Walter Reed Army Institute of Research and participated in Project Pandora. Scientists began zapping monkeys to study the biological effects of highly concentrated microwave frequencies. Similar studies were conducted at the VA Hospital in Kansas City, University of Rochester, Brooks Air Force Base, Johns Hopkins, MIT, the MITRE Corporation, University of Pennsylvania, and other domestic and foreign labs. In one study, Dr. Jose Delgado experimented on four human subjects using radio waves, reporting they experienced different emotions, sensations, and colored visions. Delgado stated that these weapons were, quote, more dangerous than atomic destruction. With knowledge of the brain, he said, we may transform, we may shape, direct, roboticize man. I think the great danger of the future is that we will have roboticized human beings who are not aware that they have been roboticized, unquote. Dr. Delgado was in fact responsible for the development of a brain transponder that was used to roboticize human subjects.
In the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex. The potential for the disastrous rise of misplaced power exists and will persist.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
In the dead silence of the morning, at 5:29:45 Mountain War Time, the Jornada del Muerto was bathed in an intense flash of a light that man had only seen from the stars.
The women peace campers at Grenham Common, England, claimed that they were attacked by U.S. electromagnetic weapons from within the U.S. airbase. Scientists from Electronics Today measured some form of electromagnetic wave that was responsible for the illnesses they suffered. A team of doctors from the Medical Campaign Against Nuclear Weapons compiled a report on the condition of the affected women. The women first noticed a pattern of illness emerging in 1984. Women at different points around the camp appeared to experience similar symptoms at the same time, even though they were not in contact with one another. Large numbers of women complained of sudden feelings of extreme tiredness shortly before major events, such as the departure of a cruise missile convoy. Readings taken with a wide-range signal strength meter showed marked increases in the background signal level near one of the women's camps at the time they claimed to be experiencing ill effects, including vertigo, retinal bleeding, burnt face even at night, nausea, sleep disturbances, palpitations, loss of concentration, loss of memory, disorientation, severe headaches, temporary paralysis, faulty speech coordination, irritability, and a sense of panic in non-panic situations, and in one case, a circulatory failure that required emergency treatment. Many of these symptoms have been associated in medical literature with exposure to microwaves, and especially through low-intensity or non-thermal exposure. These effects have been reviewed by Dr. Robert Becker, twice nominated for the Nobel Prize and a specialist in electromagnetic effects. His report confirms that the symptoms mirror those he would expect to see had microwave weapons been deployed. British defense officials have denied any form of electronic signal was being used against the protesters. The Department of Justice Electromagnetic Weapons Program. The Department of Defense uses the Department of Justice to develop and test non-lethal weapons as an aspect of deniability because many of these applications violate existing treaties. By using the Department of Justice and classifying these programs as crowd control, they are able to avoid scrutiny and can violate the spirit of the law without technically being in violation of international treaties. In 1993, the National Institute of Justice Initiative on Less Than Lethal Weapons recommended that state and local police departments in America utilize psychotronic, electromagnetic, and other mind control weapons against American citizens involved in, quote, domestic disturbances, an open-ended term that could include family arguments. The report said, quote, short-term research will be completed to adopt military technology to use by domestic law enforcement, including laser microwave and electromagnetic weapons, unquote. The Washington Post reported, quote, the Pentagon and the DOJ have agreed to share state-of-the-art military technology with civilian law enforcement agencies, including exotic non-lethal weapons, unquote. This new approach to law enforcement was showcased in a 3-day secret conference on non-lethal weaponry at the Applied Physics Laboratory at Johns Hopkins University in Maryland. The conference head was Colonel John B. Alexander, Program Manager for Non-Lethal Psychotronic Defense, Los Alamos National Laboratory. Attending the meeting was Attorney General Janet Reno, military weapons specialists, and representatives from state and local police departments. Subjects included radio frequency weapons, high-powered microwave technology, acoustic technology, voice synthesis, and application of extreme frequency electromagnetic fields to non-lethal weapons.
Question about some of the technology that you're developing to fight the war on terror, specifically directed energy and high-powered microwave technology. Do you, when do you envision that you can weaponize that type of technology?
It is in, for the most part, the kinds of things you're talking about are in varying early stages. Do you have anything you'd add?
I don't think I would add much. I think they are in early stages and probably not ready for employment at this point.
But you sound like you're willing to experiment with
it. I think that's the point. And I think, and it's, we have, I think, from the beginning of this conflict, I think General Franks has been very open to looking at new things if there are new things available, and has been willing to put them into the fight even before they've been fully wrung out. And I think that's not referring to these two particular cases of directed energy or high-powered microwave, but...
Just the head was burned, and the other parts of the bodies wasn't anything happened on it.
Al-Ghazali reported that he had seen three passengers in a car, all dead, with their faces and teeth burnt, the body intact, and no sign of projectiles.
There wasn't any bullet. I saw they teeth, just their teeth, and no eyes. All of them, with the body, nothing for the bodies, just the teeth and all the, the heads were burned.
There were other inexplicable aspects. The terrain where the battle took place was dug up by the American military and replaced with other fresh earth. The bodies that were not hit by projectiles had shrunk to just slightly more than 1 meter in height.
Except that the bodies is killed by the bullets. Most of them that become very small. It's like that, something like that.
Talk with the colleague, Dr. Saad Al-Faluji, which is the chief surgeon in that hospital. Dr. Al-Faluji said to me that from the survivors that he operated, that they said they did not hear any noise. So there was no explosion to hear, no metal fragments or shrapnels or bullets in the bodies. So they themselves were thinking of some strange kinds of weapon which they did not know.
No gunshot wounds.
No. I don't know what it was really. We are here 10 surgeons. We couldn't decide what was the weapon which been hit this car.
But inside the bodies you did not discover ordinary bullets?
We didn't find bullets.
Yeah.
We didn't find bullets. But most of the passenger people been dead, so they took them immediately to the refrigerator. We couldn't decept and see. But those who are alive, we couldn't find any kind of shells. We didn't find shells inside their body. Outside,
it seems to be a new weapon.
It seems a new weapon.
They try to do experiments on our civilian.
We don't know what was.
Nobody can identify what the type of this was.
26 in the past, about 20 of them, some of them have no head, the head been cut. Some of them, the arms, the legs. The only one who didn't injure was the driver. And really, I don't know how he reached our hospital. Because one hand, one arm was in his lap, one head beside him. It was a very, very strange, horrible thing.
Horrible.
In the roof of the car, there was part
brain.
Of the body's phantom intestine, brains.
Yes,
so
all parts of the body.
It was a miserable, it was very, very, very,
I
very miserable.
I told them before.
Do you have idea with what kind of weapons they attacked that bus?
This the bus, we didn't know what kind of weapon would be hit. Really, what we saw, cut arms, cut legs, cut head, abdomen, open abdomen.
Intelligence agencies have infiltrated and created some satanic groups, with the resurgence of these groups beginning in 1966. Particularly with the birth of the Church of Satan, founded by Anton LaVey. LaVey studied criminology in San Francisco and worked in the San Francisco Police Department Crime Lab. He also worked as an informant for Interpol. Prior to the Church of Satan, LaVey ran a group called the Magic Circle. LaVey's most famous associate is the National Security Agency General Michael Aquino. At the time of his membership in LaVey's group, Aquino was an Army specialist in intelligence and psychological warfare. In 1973, he became the executive officer of the 306th Psychological Operations Battalion, contemporary with his founding of the Church of Set. General Michael Aquino wrote, "From Psyop to Mind War, the Psychology of Victory." Aquino's thesis stated that enemy populations could be subdued by inflicting a state of psychological terror and feelings of imminent destruction. He discusses the use of psychotronic weapons or electromagnetic weapons that influence the mind. Capitulation could be induced without firing a shot by extremely low-frequency signals piggybacked on broadcasts of radio, TV, or microwave communications in order to influence and manipulate the thoughts and feelings of the target population. During the 1960s, he was prominent in the Church of Satan and a close friend of Anton LaVey, until he started his own Church of Set. A police intelligence report dated July 1, 1981, reads, quote, "The Church of Set is a group of hundreds of members that operates on a national level. Michael Aquino is the official head and rules through a council of nine who are in fact his lieutenants," unquote. At least two members of the Council of Nine at that time were members of Army Intelligence. In the late 1980s, Aquino was accused by the San Francisco Police Department of being involved in a satanic child molestation ring centered on the daycare at the Presidio military base where Aquino was stationed at the time. Probable victims numbered at 68, many of whom had contracted venereal disease. 22 families filed $66 million in claims against the Army, claiming that criminal charges against Michael Aquino were dropped due to pressure from the Army. General Aquino admitted to renting the German castle where the Nazi SS were formed and reenacting the secret ceremony among fellow intelligence officers dressed in full Nazi regalia. General Aquino is now the highest-ranking officer in the National Security Agency, along with General Black and General Hayden. It is important to remember that General Aquino is first and foremost a military intelligence officer with over 40 years' experience in counterinsurgency operations and an expert in psychological warfare. General Aquino's psychological warfare campaign has started or infiltrated cults and other closed systems as part of a concerted effort to control large numbers of people and to destabilize the centers of constitutional and legal authority both here in the United States and in other nations. This methodology is part of a concerted plan that spans several generations. The Church of Satan and the Church of Set, as well as other cults and mainstream organizations, are closed systems with their own belief systems that are insular and separate from the reality that most people take for granted. These closed systems allow large numbers of people to be manipulated into performing antisocial acts that most members of the greater society would not contemplate. Aquino first participated in MKUltra-related activities in Vietnam as part of the Phoenix program in the 1960s. These ongoing MKUltra operations are functioning as a counterinsurgency and infiltration operation aimed at destabilizing the United States and other industrialized nations. The following cults have been used by General Aquino or his associates to continue MKUltra operations outside of the laboratory. The mass suicides at Jonestown of 890 people had similar threads, a cult with sinister connections. Jim Jones, who had connections to the CIA, set up his utopian experiment on the same land the CIA had used to train mercenaries to fight in Angola. According to investigators, the Jonestown experiment was conceived of by Dr. Lawrence Laird Layton, staffed by him and financed by Layton. The African-American cult had at its core a Caucasian inner council composed of Layton and his family. Layton was a chemist in the Manhattan Project and head of the Army's Chemical Warfare Research Division in the 1950s. The People's Temple cult took over the Mendocino State Hospital as a part of a government pilot project to evaluate the feasibility of deinstitutionalizing mental patients. After a reduction in state funding, most of the patients at the Mendocino State Psychiatric Hospital were released into the custody of the People's Temple. Congressman Leo Ryan was assassinated in his attempt to investigate the cult. The pathologist in Guyana reported 80-90% of the victims' bodies had fresh needle marks. Other victims had been shot or strangled. In 1981, the survivors sued the former head of the CIA for, quote, "enhancing the economic and political powers of James Warren Jones," unquote, and of conducting mind control and drug experimentation on the temple flock. The Manson family was associated with the Process Church, which, according to the Utah Department of Public Safety, moved to southern Utah and changed their name to the Foundation. In a 1990 internal memo authored by church authority Glenn L. Pace, allegations were made of ritual abuse and human sacrifice. Pace writes that he has met with 60 victims of ritual abuse, but there were probably 2 to 3 times as many victims. 53 were female and 7 were male, 8 of which were children. All are members of the Mormon Church. 45 victims alleged they witnessed or participated in human sacrifice. The majority were abused by relatives. All had developed psychological problems such as multiple personality disorder. Quote, "The memories come in layers. The first might be of incest. Another layer might well be the memory of seeing people hurt or even killed. Then they remember having seen babies killed. Another layer is realizing that they participated in the sacrifices. One of the most painful memories may be that they even sacrificed their own baby. I have only seen those coming forth to get help. They are in their 20s and 30s for the most part. I can only assume that it is expanding geometrically, and am horrified by the numbers represented by the generation who are now children and teenagers," unquote. Dr. Joseph Mengele found that trauma bonding and mind control work best when the victim is forced to kill someone they love, usually a twin. The Franklin Conspiracy refers to a sexual blackmail operation and savings and loan fraud that began in Omaha, Nebraska in the early 1980s. Larry King, a 300-pound pedophile, operated a national child prostitution network that catered to wealthy patrons and Republican Party insiders. King was one of the fastest rising stars in the Republican Party. He sang the national anthem at the Republican convention in 1984 and 1988. King and his associates defrauded Franklin's savings and loan of $40 million and used the residents of Boys Town and other children to videotape powerful and influential men and women engaged in sex acts with minors. These blackmail operations took place during fundraising parties for the Republican Party. Those involved stayed late for the after party that included drugs and sex with minors. The strategy of early MKUltra was to use sexual blackmail operations that targeted political figures in order to ensure continued funding from legislators. Victims who came forward testified that King and his associates performed satanic rituals and human sacrifices. Many of the children who came forward with their stories have since been murdered or imprisoned. The most prominent and vocal victim has been held in solitary confinement longer than any other person in Nebraska history. Larry King served 2 years for fraud and was promptly employed by his good friend, the editor of an Omaha newspaper. The Unification Church of Reverend Sung Young Moon had close connections to the KCIA, the Korean Central Intelligence Agency, since its creation by the U.S. Central Intelligence Agency. 4 of Moon's early leaders were Army officers with KCIA credentials, and Moon's most influential aide, Dr. Bo Hai Pak, was liaison between the CIA and the KCIA, making numerous trips to the NSA headquarters at Fort Meade, Maryland. Moon's church is fabulously rich, with at least 600 front groups. It purchased the Washington Times newspaper for over $1 billion. Moon has claimed that he is the reincarnation of Jesus, Buddha, and Mohammed. He preaches love, but attacks his critics mercilessly and uses the terminology of violence and apocalyptic revelation. In March of 2004 in Washington, D.C., the Reverend Moon was crowned as the Prince of Peace in a ceremony at the Dirksen Senate Office Building in the presence of 86 U.S. congressmen and 26 U.N. ambassadors. The Children of God cult in Argentina has been involved in ritual abuse of children for decades, but has evaded conviction despite voluminous, undeniable evidence and victim testimony. David Moses Berg founded the church in the 1970s and advocated using sex to entice new members into the church. Berg's own children and former members have stated that they were forced into sex between the ages of 4 and 10 years old with high-level church members. The victims also testify to a sexual blackmail and infiltration campaign aimed at some of the most powerful men in Europe, particularly in the media, legal community, and government. Powerful figures of political and financial support for the family include Libyan President Muammar Gaddafi, Chilean dictator Augusto Pinochet, and King Juan Carlos of Spain. The sect currently estimates its numbers at 300,000 converts in 60 countries. In 1992, the Family Children's Choir sang in the White House for Barbara Bush to kick off a Christmas show in the East Room. The sect also sang for George Bush Sr. after he toured the damage of Hurricane Andrew in South Florida. The Cult Awareness Network was founded 2 decades ago in the wake of the mass suicides in Guyana that claimed the lives of 890 of Jim Jones' followers. The nonprofit national organization assisted the desperate loved ones of people caught up in the cult scene. The organizations targeted by CAN were the KKK, the Aryan Nations, dozens of obscure fundamentalist and evangelical Christian groups, the Church of Satan, the Moonies, followers of political extremist Lyndon LaRouche, and the Church of Scientology. An organized blizzard of lawsuits produced judgments totaling $5 million and led to CAN's financial ruin. In 1996, their logo, furniture, and phone number were auctioned off by a bankruptcy judge. Scientology lawyers took possession of 20 years' worth of CAN's highly sensitive case files containing information on thousands of people who had turned to CAN for help in rescuing their friends and relatives. Scientology is known for harassing its enemies and retaliating against suppressives, people who ridicule Scientology teachings. These teachings include L. Ron Hubbard's decree that humans are made up of clusters of spirits called Thetans, who were banished to Earth about 75 million years ago by an evil galactic ruler named Xenu. Hubbard was a pulp fiction writer who'd served in the Navy and hit it big in 1950 by coming up with the concept of Dianetics that he dubbed a modern science of mental health that remained at the core of Scientology practice. One of its staples is a simplified lie detector called an E-meter, which is supposed to measure electrical changes in the skin while subjects discuss intimate details of their lives. Hubbard claimed that unhappiness sprang from mental aberrations called engrams, and that counseling sessions with the E-meter could help rid them of them. Scientologists refer to the extensive and expensive process of clearing the mind in order for this to occur as auditing. But during the 1970s, the IRS conducted some auditing of its own and accused L. Ron Hubbard of skimming millions of dollars from the church, laundering it through dummy corporations, and stashing it in Swiss bank accounts. Although he died before the case was adjudicated, his wife and 10 other former church leaders went to prison in the early 1980s for infiltrating, burglarizing, and wiretapping dozens of private and government agencies in an attempt to block their investigations. The majority of Masons join and undergo rituals and rites that seem to have no meaning. It is only when they enter the highest levels, the circle within a circle, if you will, that the secret knowledge is shared as to what the organization and its rituals are really about. This knowledge is imparted to a select few who achieve 32nd degree status or higher, What these rites are, and what this secret knowledge is, has yet to be proven. The Masons are one of the most prominent links between victims of satanic ritual abuse. Victims of SRA are, in effect, victims of MKUltra experiments in childhood. Literally thousands of people from different parts of the country who have never been in contact with each other are telling essentially the exact same story, that as very young children, these people were forced to participate in satanic ritual abuse, including child rape and ritual sacrifice. The consistency of the stories, the links to MKUltra and satanic ritual abuse, seem to be a fantastic story at first, but victim testimony is very consistent, and the association of both programs to high-level Mason members has been repeated many times. Many of the personalities involved in the original MKUltra experiments were high-level Masons, including Dr. Sidney Gottlieb, Dr. George Estabrooks, Dr. Ewan Cameron, and others in the intelligence community. Masons have been accused of many things over the years, but it is equally likely that the Masons were infiltrated by CIA perpetrators of MKUltra in an effort to control a closed system and have access to experimental subjects. MKUltra was moved out of the laboratory and into these closed systems of various kinds that could be manipulated and used to supply large numbers of children for mind control experiments and blackmail operations without directly implicating the CIA. MKUltra and the False Memory Syndrome Foundation. Dr. Martin T. Orne is an original board member of the False Memory Syndrome Foundation, the FMSF, as well as a senior CIA researcher at the University of Pennsylvania's Experimental Psychiatry Laboratory. The FMSF was created to deny the existence of cult mind control and child abuse, and is staffed with psychiatrists connected to the CIA and their mind control experimentation. The phenomenon of children being coached or led to invent tales of abuse or make up such stories does exist, but comprises a small minority of the reported cases of child abuse, between 2 and 8% of all reported cases. One survey found 88% of therapists considered ritual child abuse a very real social problem. Only 5% of all child abuse cases ever enter the courtroom. Half of these end with the child returned to the custody of the abusive parent. Dr. Orne's research into hypnoprogramming at Cornell University in the 1960s was paid for by the Human Ecology Fund, which also funded some of Dr. Ewan Cameron's brainwashing and remote mind control experimentation. CIA-funded black psychiatry at that time specialized in electroshock lobotomies, drugging agents, incapacitants, hypnosis, sleep deprivation, and radio control of the brain. The FMSF founder, Dr. Ralph Underwager, and his wife openly advocate pedophilia, saying that it is God's will adults engage in sex with children. Underwager told a British reporter in 1994, quote, that scientific evidence proved 60% of all women molested as children believed the experience was good for them. Dr. Underwager is the world's foremost authority on false memory, but in court is repeatedly revealed as a charlatan. Numerous other members of the FMSF have connections to pedophilia, covert operations, and black psychiatry. Peter and Pamela Frade, executive directors of the FMSF, have been accused of child abuse by their daughter, a professor of psychology at the University of Oregon. The industrial production of FMSF stories in journals, newspapers, and TV have shaped public opinion. The very concept of false memory serves the same purpose as Holocaust denial. The major crimes are obstructed. The accused wears the veil of a martyr, and the victim is reviled. Dr. Douglas Besheroff is director of the American Enterprise Institute and former director of the National Center of Child Abuse and Neglect. He writes articles that attack the victims of abuse and has been caught fabricating statistics when claiming scientific rationale for his claims. In 1986, Besharov published Unfounded Allegations, A New Child Abuse Problem, and numerous other cover stories to confuse the issue. These individuals are engaged in a psychological warfare operation to cover up reports of the agency's mind control operations. For years, the CIA collaborated with cults, many of them founded by the government, in order to conceal the development of mind control technology. Dr. Besharov associated with Irving Kristol, a veteran CIA psychological warfare specialist. Ritual abuse skeptics with CIA connections are covering up the latest phase in CIA-sponsored mind control experimentation. The McMartin Preschool. In preparation for the McMartin Preschool child abuse trial, 389 toddlers were interviewed. Nearly all of them described abuse at the preschool, and do to this day. Some 80% had physical symptoms, including blunt force trauma of sexual areas, scarring, rectal bleeding, and sexual diseases. Paul and Shirley Eberle published the only two books available on the case, The Politics of Child Abuse, 1986. They achieved national status as child abuse experts. In courts of law, their work is frequently cited. They lecture widely to receptive audiences and have been speakers at a conference held by victims of child abuse laws, Vocal. These two individuals ran an underground tabloid, Finger, in the 1970s. Finger delved heavily into sadomasochistic sex, sex with children, and sex acts involving human excrement. These two pedophiles seek to portray every abuser as a victim of mass hysteria, satanic panic, and witch hunts. They are just two of many. The parents of the McMartin preschoolers hired scientists and technicians who unearthed a series of underground tunnels beneath the school, confirming the children's testimony. The longest tunnel was 45 feet long and 6 feet below the school, with a 9-foot chamber spoken of by the children. Another branch led to the triplex next door, surfacing beneath a rollaway bathtub. Forensic tests on thousands of objects found at the site included 200 animal bones. The tunnels were dug in 1966, the year of the school's construction, by the father of the defendant, Charles Buckey. Buckey built the school and worked for Hughes Tool Company. There is an old adage, Hughes is the CIA.
Pick it up and put it in this bag. That's right. And next will be a small, harmless snake. Pick it up behind the head. That's right. And put it in here. That's right. All the way, make sure it's in. That's right. And now there'll be a large snake, which you'll pick up behind the head. Behind the head. Quickly. Let go. That's right. And your eyes are closing now and you're sinking deeper. And as I ask you to open your eyes, you're going to be aware that there's a beaker in front of you. Do not touch the beaker. And there will be two other beakers also in front of you. You look at them. It's all right to open your eyes now. You'll see the beakers. Now I want you to focus on this beaker. Shortly I'll ask you to do something. This beaker you want to be careful of because it is filled with acid. It is nitric acid. You've had chemistry, haven't you? And you know that nitric acid dissolves copper. I'm going to put a penny into the acid. Look what happens. Now I want you to reach in with your hand and pick up the penny out of the acid and put it into this beaker. Take it very quickly. Go ahead. Put it in there. That's right. First, put your whole hand and close your eyes. Nothing else at all. Only my voice. Nothing else at all. That's right. That's right. All right. Now I want you to put your hand in this beaker. That's right. Only my voice. Nothing else at all. That's right. Now, when you open your eyes, you're going to be aware that the beaker is still there in front of you. But beside you, you'll be aware that there's a man who's been responsible for all of the nuisance today, all of the discomfort. And you're going to become more and more annoyed at him as you think about that. In fact, you're going to pick up the beaker and throw the contents right at him. You're going to take the beaker and you'll feel good doing that. All right, and you'll do it quickly. Open your eyes, you'll see the beaker in front of you. Pick it up and throw it at him. Throw it at him. That's it. As you saw, we changed the acid for colored water while the subject's eyes were closed. The subject not only couldn't see this, but wasn't really aware of it because the smell of the acid was strong enough in the area to be quite compelling. Yet she threw the acid, what she thought was acid, at someone else. But in the same token, she picked up the rattlesnake and she was willing to take a penny out of the fuming acid. The reason why she did it, however, was not so much the fact that she was hypnotized, but the fact that she knew that I couldn't afford to have anybody be hurt, and I wouldn't want anybody to be hurt, and for that reason she trusted me. And it was the trust that mattered.
I decided that I liked Anton LaVey. He was a pleasant man. He believed in what he was doing. And underneath his somewhat Mardi Gras exterior, I sensed that there was an individual who did in fact have a new perspective on the human equation, on what humanity is.
The Trojan Horse. The Athenians laid siege to Troy for many years and then abruptly departed, leaving the Trojan Horse. The prophet Laocoon warned the city that the Trojan Horse held their doom. He hurled his javelin into the side of the Trojan horse and was attacked by a giant multi-headed serpent that emerged from the sea and pulled he and his sons into the sea to their deaths. The inhabitants took this as an omen to mean that the Trojan horse was a gift from the gods and thus sacred. They brought the offering inside the city gates, and at night the Athenians emerged, opened the gates to their awaiting army, and the city was sacked and destroyed, the men killed, and the women and children enslaved. The Nazi Trojan Horse. Nazi Germany personifies the technological totalitarian state and serves as a model. The subjugation of the Weimar Republic began with the creation of private militias that were used as a springboard to infiltrate the German military and finally the police force. Once the German police forces were co-opted, there was no going back. The Reichstag fire was an excuse to seize power and carry out the Night of the Long Knives, the execution of hundreds of internal political rivals, opponents, and potential threats. Once Hitler had crossed the Rubicon of mass assassination, he publicly declared his actions above the law. The pseudoscience of eugenics, the dogma of German racial superiority, and the theoretical subhuman level of other races was the rationale for wars of annihilation. Hitler's plan was to depopulate vast regions of the East and replace them with Germanic stock. Lebensraum, or living space, was the key phrase. 10 million Jews came under their geographical control, of which 6 million were systematically murdered in an effort to wipe out the Jewish race. 3 million others perished in the camps, including Gypsies, Slavs, and other supposed subhuman races, as well as homosexuals, dissident Catholic priests, prisoners of war, union leaders, political opponents, Germans caught aiding Jews, religious sects such as Jehovah's Witnesses, and the intellectuals of conquered nations. The concentration camp of Auschwitz processed 4,756 human beings a day. The Nazi propaganda was so irresistible that many Jews and other targeted groups joined the Nazi movement. In the aftermath of the war, 50 million people had died, and Europe lay in ashes. The Allies wanted answers. How had arguably the most civilized and technologically advanced nation on Earth descended into the pit of hell? Who were these men? Were they madmen? Worst of all, if it could happen there, could it happen here? The psychiatrists that studied the prisoners at the Nuremberg trials wrote their collective portrait. Their collective IQ is 140. They have a rigid view of the world, black and white without gray. They were born followers who needed someone to tell them what to think. Though they had unusual personalities among them, they were not insane. The answers the Allies received were not the answers they were prepared to hear. No, they were not madmen, and yes, it could happen here. The psychiatrist noted that there were plenty of similar individuals in the United States who would gladly step over half the bodies of their fellow countrymen to control the remainder. Remote viewing programs were publicly touted as an attempt to spy on the USSR using psychic powers to find hidden Russian bases and gather intelligence information. The military intelligence personalities involved in remote viewing have ties to development programs for microwave and radio frequency radiation weapons that are designed to influence the central nervous system, referred to collectively as psychotronics. These personalities have ties to religious cults as well. Remote viewing began with Operation Scanate and Operation Grill Flame, run by the NSA and INSCOM at Fort Meade under such personalities as Lieutenant Colonel Thomas Bearden, Albert Stubblebine, Ingo Swan, Ed Dames, Harold Putoff, Russell Targ, Paul Smith, and others. Operation Scanate leader Thomas Bearden went on to lead the American Psychotronics Association. Project Grill Flame leaders Ed Dames and Albert Stubblebine began Psytech Corporation, a private remote viewing company which holds the Smirnov patent for a psychotronic weapon. Remote viewers Harold Putoff and Ed Dames have counseled the traumatized victims of death cults and mass shootings such as the Jonestown mass deaths and the Columbine shootings, even though these men are not counselors, but physicists and military intelligence officers by training. Dr. Harold Putoff exemplifies the contradiction. He is a former NSA officer who developed the pulse microwave laser. He is a remote viewer and a high-level Scientologist who likes to counsel traumatized victims of cults. The concept of remote viewing is being used as a cover, a psychological warfare operation, in order to screen the development of psychotronic weapons and conduct MK-Ultra operations. The same people involved in remote viewing programs for the NSA and INSCOM at Fort Meade and Psytech Corporation are also closely tied to psychotronic weapons development and religious cults that use MK-Ultra methodology to induce multiple personality disorder. These strange threads, such as non-lethal psychotronic weapons development, remote viewing operations, and cults engaged in ritual abuse, are all woven together, suggesting that MK-Ultra and non-lethal psychotronic weapons development have evolved into an elaborate psychological warfare campaign that functions as an infiltration operation and a counterinsurgency aimed at the people and government of the United States. COINTELPRO stands for Counterintelligence Program, primarily run by the FBI as a covert action program against domestic dissidents. The use of infiltration, psychological warfare, harassment through the legal system, and the use of extralegal force and violence, including murder, probably began in the 1950s and is now a permanent feature of U.S. government. Targets included the civil rights movement, the women's rights movement, the anti-war movement, the environmental movement, opposition political parties, and basically any progressive group in American society. The Senate and congressional hearings into the activities of the FBI and CIA were crushed. The Senate committee's report was edited by the agencies being investigated before its publication. The House committee's report, including an account of FBI and CIA obstruction of its inquiry, was suppressed altogether. Senator Church and Congressman Pike, the committee chairs, were both targeted in their re-election campaigns by the intelligence agencies and defeated, their careers destroyed. The Freedom of Information Act did open up access to FBI documents, and lawsuits forced the release of some COINTELPRO files to the media, but the most important files were withheld or destroyed, and former operatives report that the most heinous crimes were never committed to writing. William C. Sullivan, who ran the COINTEL program in the 1960s, was killed in a 1977 hunting accident shortly before giving testimony to a grand jury in 1977. The only two FBI officials who were ever prosecuted for COINTELPRO crimes were quickly pardoned by President Ford. There was an appearance of reform that was largely aimed at placating a weary public that had become disillusioned after Watergate. The most prominent target of COINTELPRO in the 1960s was Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr., who received a blackmail letter from J. Edgar Hoover that detailed the existence of Dr. King's extramarital affairs and suggested he should suicide himself to preclude the release of the material to the press and its negative effect on his family and his movement. The surveillance of Dr. King included the 112th Military Intelligence Unit and even the use of U-2 spy planes to take photographs. Dr. King was marked, barely a month before his murder, for elimination as a potential messiah who could unify and electrify the black movement. The FBI planned to replace him, quote, in his role of the leadership of the Negro people, with conservative black lawyer Samuel Pierce, who was later named to Ronald Reagan's cabinet. The theme of forced suicide is repeated on others targeted by COINTELPRO. Jean Seberg was an actress involved in civil rights. Her husband received a forged letter from the FBI detailing a fictitious affair she was supposedly having with a black activist. The actress was pregnant at the time and attempted suicide, had a miscarriage, and eventually did commit suicide. Forced suicide on a COINTELPRO target allows intelligence agencies deniability for the crime. In effect, it is the perfect crime. A total of 2,300 officially approved COINTEL actions were admitted to the Senate Intelligence Committee, but thousands more have since been revealed. Ultimately, FBI documents disclosed 6 major programs. FBI operatives were directed to disrupt meetings of targeted groups, spread rumors, inflamed disagreements over what people normally fight over, money, politics, race, gender, sex, and to exacerbate rivalries and jealousy, to lead activists into unnecessary danger, and to set them up for false prosecutions. False news stories, forged documents, and anonymous letters and phone calls, as well as pressure on landlords and their employers, make up just some of the strategies used against activists. The major violence of the domestic terrorist campaign was directed at the black nationalist and American Indian movements. These individuals were readily imprisoned on false charges or assassinated. British Commander Frank Kitson first codified counterinsurgency operations theory in his book Low Intensity Operations, Subversion, Insurgency, and Peacekeeping, and he insists that infiltration and psychological operations be mounted against dissident groups in normal times, before any mass movement can develop. These tactics were adopted into COINTELPRO against American citizens in peacetime, with considerable energy spent ensuring that the different progressive groups did not link up and cooperate. Specifically, the anti-war movement, composed of suburban white youth, and the black nationalist movement. There was also a major effort to preclude African-American leaders from linking up with leaders in Africa. Infiltration of the KKK by the FBI reached 10 to 20% of its membership at the height of the civil rights struggle, and these assets, along with neo-Nazi party members, were used to attack civil rights workers and activists. COINTEL operations are presently being incorporated into the development of microwave and radio frequency radiation weapons. Dissidents that in the past were visibly attacked or assassinated in a traditional manner are now targeted for elimination using electromagnetic weapons. These internal dissidents are used as human guinea pigs and experimental subjects in terminal experiments that are designed to force a suicide, incarceration, or premature death due to the effects of ionizing and non-ionizing radiation. These political assassinations are accomplished with invisible bullets that leave no obvious injuries. The driving of a target to suicide using microwave hearing as well as other techniques is perfectly deniable because these individuals are tormented invisibly, unable to seek help from the psychiatric community due to the symptoms of the attacks mimicking symptoms of schizophrenia that naturally affect several million Americans. Thus, the intelligence agencies have achieved perfect deniability for their crimes. CIA blowback. If the U.S. intelligence agencies are currently engaged in war crimes using directed energy weapons, it would be logical to expect a pattern of prior behaviors that exhibit similar criminal activity. It is certain that the United States has destabilized dozens of countries and overthrown their elected governments. Just how many countries is uncertain. In Iran, in 1953, the Eisenhower administration joined forces with British intelligence to overthrow the government of Iran, which was seeking a larger share of its country's oil revenues. CIA Director Alan Dulles and Kermit Roosevelt, the son of FDR, were able to direct Iranian army officers in a coup to overthrow Mossadegh, the elected government, and reinstall the fictitious monarchy of the Shah. The Shah immediately granted British Petroleum a 40% share of the oil concession, and American firms received 40% as a reward for their participation. The overthrow of Mossadegh emboldened the CIA and became a blueprint for future destabilization operations. Mossadegh represented the legitimate aspirations of a nationalist democracy that was thwarted in the name of anti-communism. The resulting chaos and radicalization of Iran is a direct result of interference in the internal affairs of that nation, what is referred to as blowback, the unintended negative consequences of covert actions against foreign elected governments. The Shah was described in a confidential CIA report as a dangerous sociopath who suffered from a dominating father and a sense of the illegitimacy of his mandate to rule. Savak was the name of the Shah's feared secret police set up with the help of the CIA. The excesses of the Shah and the American selected and trained Savak led to the emergence of the Ayatollah Khomeini and a hostile regime that views the U.S. as a force for evil in the world, hence the litany of referring to the United States as the Great Satan. Guatemala. In 1954, the CIA accepted and carried out a proposal from United Brands, Chiquita Banana, to overthrow the Guatemalan government, which was the only democratically elected government Guatemala had ever had. United Brands and the CIA replaced that government with 40 years of bloodshed under a series of barbaric right-wing dictators. U.S. taxpayers continue to fund these regimes under the repeated threat that if they do not, the Guatemalan people will fall prey to communism. A mere 2% of the population owned 72% of the land. 90% of the landowners were confined to the poorest 15% of the land. United Brands owned the railroads, the ports, and vast tracts of some of the most productive land on earth. Guatemalan President Arbenz had won the election with 65% of the vote in 1950. He tried to fulfill his mandate, which was land reform and a minimum wage modeled on FDR's efforts in the U.S. He seized the largest land holdings, including his own family's, and distributed 1.5 million acres to 100,000 families. The land was paid for in 25-year interest-bearing bonds, perfectly within the guidelines of the Kennedy-era Alliance for Progress program, or U.S. programs in El Salvador and Chile. The only difference were the investments by United Brands and the political influence they could bring to bear on the Arbenz government. In 1966, a swell of revolution brought a full-scale U.S.-sponsored counterinsurgency response program, including arms, advisors, and even Green Berets. A State Department study analyzed the program years later and stated, quote, "To eliminate a few hundred guerrillas, the government killed perhaps 10,000 Guatemalan peasants." Father Ronald Hennessy wrote of one event among many. July 14, 1982, the local military commander sent word for all the people of the village of Penetinac to be assembled for his 11 o'clock arrival. At 4 p.m., all of the men, with their hands tied behind their backs, were escorted by the soldiers into one house, shot, stabbed, and piled one on top of the other and covered with burnable items from the house, which were sprinkled with gasoline and set on fire. The women were treated the same as the men, differing only in that some had live babies on their backs when they were stacked for burning. The other children were tied, one to another, and pulled alive into the flames of a third house by the soldiers. In September of 1981, an association of Guatemalan coroners had complained that they couldn't keep up with the demand for autopsies because violent deaths had increased so rapidly, 50% higher each month than the last. Michael Deaver was instrumental in the election of Ronald Reagan in 1980, and one of his three close advisors, along with Ed Meese and James Baker. His public relations firm, Deaver and Hannaford, took on various right-wing Central and South American landowners and businessmen as clients, among them a group of Guatemalans.
Was not a Guatemalan government. It was a foreign government controlled by foreigners.
And that happened just here in the continent,
right here in America.
Iraq. In Iraq in 1958, General Abdel Karim Qasim led a coup, took power, and proclaimed a republic. He legalized the Communist Party and decreed land reform, granting autonomy to the Kurds. CIA Director Alan Dulles declared Iraq, quote, "the most dangerous spot in the world," and in 1963, the CIA-supported Ba'ath Party overthrew Qasim. The Ba'ath Party shared power until 1968, when the CIA again instigated a coup that culminated in the rise of Saddam Hussein. Hussein had been on the CIA payroll since his early 20s. In 1980, Saddam invaded Iran in fear of the potential Iranian revolutionary influence among his country's majority Shiites. Iran began to win the war in 1982, and the U.S., in fear of the Iranian revolution, began to covertly aid and arm Saddam. The Reagan administration funneled $5.5 billion through the Atlanta branch of the Italian bank Banca Nazionale del Lavoro, guaranteed by the taxpayers under the Commodity Credit Corporation, to, quote, "promote American farm exports," unquote. Between 1986 and 1989, 73 transactions took place that included bacterial cultures for anthrax production, advanced computers, and equipment to repair jets and rockets. In 2002, Iraq was forced to deliver an 11,800-page dossier on the history of its weapons program to the UN Security Council. Bush administration officials took possession of the document first and cut 8,000 pages that detailed American and Western company sales of weapons and dual-use technology sold to Iraq prior to 1991. The legacy of the NSA Act of 1947 that established the national security state had the obvious consequences of the overthrow of dozens of legitimately elected foreign governments during the Cold War. The unintended consequences of blowback has led to a more hostile environment for U.S. national interest in the 21st century, but it has led to other less obvious consequences to the American Republic itself. The power of the U.S. intelligence agencies to overthrow foreign governments at will has also impacted the domestic American political landscape. The ability to destabilize the world almost at will has conferred the same ability to these agencies in American politics. For men with this kind of power, the temptation to play God on the American landscape and to control the future direction and fate of the United States has been irresistible.
The temptation to use public power and play God is almost irresistible.
The Golden Triangle. In China in 1949, the communists under Mao Zedong drove out the U.S.-backed nationalist warlord Chiang Kai-shek. With his defeated army, the KMT, the Kuomintang, they fled to the Golden Triangle and to Taiwan. Within the Golden Triangle, they took over opium production to finance weapons purchases and the finer things in life. By the 1950s, heroin had become a nationwide concern in the United States. From Senate hearings to popular movies, criminologists blamed addicts for soaring crime rates. These KMT operations were hidden from the U.S. public for 30 years, and it is only recently Afghanistan has captured 90% of the world heroin market. The U.S. exploited the Hmong and Montagnard tribesmen as a source of opium and used the CIA's Air America to bring in guns and supplies in exchange for drugs. Large quantities of heroin appeared in the United States, much of it smuggled inside the bodies of dead American GIs. Addiction plagued the Army in Vietnam to the point of reducing their fighting capacity, and after the war, these men brought their drug problem home with them. The U.S. government promoted the drug traffic and intervened to make sure traffic would not be discovered. In the words of one former investigator, quote, "You'd be running a criminal investigation, say narcotics. You'd find out that Inspector so-and-so of your national police is involved in this. You investigate up to a point, and you can't go any further. It would go to our headquarters, and then it would go to Washington, and nothing would ever happen. The intelligence gleaned from these people was more important than stopping the drug traffic." The senior public relations man for the DEA offers the explanation, quote, "Their mission was to get people to fight against the communists, not to stop the drug traffic." Iran-Contra. A secret program by the Reagan administration circumvented Congress and illegally sold weapons to Iran, a terrorist nation, in order to pay for a guerrilla war against the Sandinista Nicaraguan government. When the operation was uncovered, it also uncovered an off-the-books operation that, in the words of Senator Daniel Inouye, was a secret government with its own permanent funding mechanism and its own army, navy, and air force. The exposure of the Iran-Contra operation revealed the tip of the iceberg. Admiral Richard Secord ran a many-faceted program that concentrated on banking fraud, drug smuggling, and illegal arms dealing by officers and former officers of the U.S. military. Oliver L. North, a Marine Lieutenant Colonel, was assigned to the National Security Council staff beginning in 1981 until he was fired in 1986. North was the White House official most directly involved in secretly aiding the Contras, selling arms to Iran, and diverting Iran arms sales proceeds to the Contras. North was Deputy Director for Political Military Affairs and reported to his superior National Security Advisor, Robert C. McFarland, and later, John M. Poindexter. He claimed to have taken much of his direction from Central Intelligence Agency Director William Casey. North testified repeatedly that he believed President Reagan was aware and approving of his activities. North was indicted in 1988 on 16 Iran-Contra charges. He was found guilty on 3 counts. His convictions were vacated in 1990 when an appeals court found that witnesses in his trial were prejudiced by his immunized congressional testimony. Many figures that came under criminal investigation and prosecution in Iran-Contra, like John Poindexter, Elliot Abrams, Richard Armitage, Dick Cheney, Otto Reich, Colin Powell, and John Negroponte, returned to serve in both Bush administrations without serious challenge from Congress. The Contras and the Crips, a San Francisco Bay Area drug ring, sold tons of cocaine to the Crips and Blood street gangs of Los Angeles, funneled millions in profits directly to the Contra guerrillas, run by the Central Intelligence Agency. This drug network opened the first pipeline between Colombia's cocaine cartels and the black neighborhoods of Los Angeles, a city now known as the crack capital of the world. Gary Webb broke the story that no other major newspaper would run, and was found murdered in what can only be described as a staged suicide.
We had Contra pilots flying out of Ilopango, smuggling drugs into the U.S., cocaine specifically.
For America, bound for military airfields in Florida and Texas, offloaded out of sight of the law, then shipped to California and other points in the U.S.
Point blank, stay away from it. It's a covert operation being run by the White House.
The highest councils of our government, in the White House and in the Justice Department. There is no question of that. I can document that.
Turns up wrongdoing. If it turns up wrongdoing, we will bring the people to justice and make them accountable.
The Russian Mind Control Program. Controlled Offensive Behavior, USSR, is a 1972 U.S. Army study of Soviet mind control experimentation. The Russian Directed Energy Weapons Program focused on targeting of individuals, not groups. Soviet dissidents were the target of microwave anti-personnel weapons and mind-altering techniques that sought, quote, the total submission of one's will to some outside force. Electromagnetic weapon mind control surfaced in the 1973 Russian Conference on Psychotronic Research. The agenda for the Prague meeting included the following five topics: erasure of the subconscious mind, development of ESP, induction of paranormal effects in dreams, the mechanical equivalent of neuropsychic energy, and the psi gene. The Soviets were known to have potent blinding lasers. They were also feared to have developed acoustic and radio wave weapons. A 1987 issue of Soviet Military Power, a Cold War Pentagon publication, warned that the Soviets might be close to, quote, a prototype short-range tactical radio frequency weapon. The Washington Post reported that year that the Soviets had used such weapons to kill goats at 1 kilometer's range. The Pentagon, it turns out, had been pursuing similar devices since the 1960s. The Russian capability, demonstrated in a series of laboratory experiments dating back to the mid-1970s, could be used to suppress riots, control dissidents, demoralize or disable opposing forces, and enhance the performance of friendly special operations teams. Pioneered by government-funded Department of the Psychocorrection at the Moscow Academy Medical Academy, acoustic psychocorrection involves the transmission of specific commands via static or white noise bands into the human subconscious without upsetting other intellectual functions. Experts said laboratory demonstrations have shown encouraging results after exposure of less than 1 minute. Decades of research and development and millions of rubles have produced the ability to alter behavior on willing and unwilling subjects. In an effort to restrict potential misuse of this capability, senior Russian research scientists, diplomats, military officials, and officials of the Russian Ministry of Higher Education, Science and Technology Policy are beginning to provide limited demonstrations for their U.S. counterparts. Further evaluations of key technologies in the U.S. are being planned, and discussions are aimed at creating a framework for bringing the issue under bilateral and multilateral control. Yet these military capabilities have remained largely unknown to the U.S. and Russian public. The Department of Psychocorrection at the Moscow Medical Academy acknowledged the potential danger of this capability. The Russian experts, including George Katov, a former KGB general now serving in a senior government ministry post, present in their report a list of software and hardware associated with their psychocorrection program that could be procured for as little as $80,000. According to General Katov, quote, As far as it has become possible to probe and correct psychic contents of human beings, despite their will and consciousness, by instrumental means, results having been achieved can get out of our control and be used with inhuman purposes for manipulating the collective psyche. Unquote. The Russian authors note that world opinion is not ready for dealing appropriately with the problems coming from the possibility of direct access to the human mind. Therefore, the Russian authors have proposed a bilateral center for psychocorrection technologies where U.S. and Russia can monitor and restrict the emerging capabilities. Dr. Igor Smirnov, a Russian expert on non-lethal weapons, was brought to the U.S. for a series of meetings in Virginia in 1993. The meetings were attended by representatives of the CIA, DIA, FBI, and ARPA. Civilians included representatives of the National Institute of Mental Health and directors of biomedical research. Dr. Smirnov and his non-lethal weapons technology was brought to Waco during the Branch Davidian siege in 1993 in hopes of using them on David Koresh, but a software problem reportedly made this impossible, and Smirnov could not guarantee its safety. A firm called Psychotechnologies Incorporated, based in Richmond, Virginia, entered into an agreement with the Russians to share and develop this technology for American use. Dr. Smirnov died of a heart attack in 2005, and his patent is now held exclusively by Psychotechnologies Corporation. SciTech is controlled by Colonel John B. Alexander, NSA General Michael Aquino, and Lieutenant Colonel Albert Stubblebine, among others.
He needs the money.
This is called computerized psychotechnology. First, we gather information from the subconscious. Then we determine how a specific personality works.
Officially for psychiatric use, this device was born of the long-standing Soviet effort to get inside the head of the enemy. At normal speed, the numbers on the screen appear meaningless. But when we slowed down our video frame by frame, we found subliminal flashes of words. Words like fear and neurosis. These words trigger electrical activity responses in the brain and reveal private anxieties and other weaknesses.
And this command, which is brought in bypassing the consciousness, has the same effect as a commandment. It's like a word of God. So we simply cannot disobey it.
So we said, well, what are the applications? And they said, well, they had tested with a simple phrase, bring us cake, and that they had piped that bring us cake in white noise up to the ground level, masquerading as just machinery noise, and both the workmen outside and their colleagues who worked on the ground level within 24 hours had come at different times of the day bringing them cake.
MKUltra Unclassified. The military financed all scientific research into development of directed energy weapons. After decades, when progress was on the horizon, the research became classified. The public program was shut down and restarted in conditions of absolute secrecy. The published scientific papers that concerned potential weapons and even bioelectric medicine were reduced to a trickle, but occasional information about their existence continued to emerge. The work of Dr. Michael Persinger, Igor Smirnov, Robert Becker, Eldon Bird, James Lynn, Andre Puharik, Ross Addy, Jose Delgado, Bill Van Bees, Herman Schwann, and others present sufficient evidence of the existence of these weapons. The earliest work on the effects of electromagnetic weapons on humans was done by Nikola Tesla in the early 1900s. The earliest anti-personnel electromagnetic weapons can be traced to the early to mid-1940s and possibly earlier. The first reference is existent in the U.S. Strategic Bombing Survey that reviewed Japanese research and development efforts into a death ray. Human beings, prisoners of war, were used in terminal experiments in the laboratory. Summarizing the Japanese efforts after World War II, Allied scientists concluded that a death ray apparatus might be developed that could kill unshielded human beings at a distance of 5 to 10 miles. Research on living organisms revealed that waves from 2 meters to 60 centimeters in length caused hemorrhage of the lungs, whereas waves shorter than 2 meters destroyed brain cells. Dr. Andre Puharik studied the effects of radio waves on animals at Northwestern University in the late 1940s. He later founded a laboratory called Round Table Foundation of Electrobiology. Puharik was employed at the Army's Chemical and Biological Warfare Center at Fort Detrick, Maryland, researching the effects of LSD for the CIA in 1954. Puharik perfected the radio tooth implant, a small little relay receiver and transmitter. Dr. Alan Fry, a biophysicist at GE's Advanced Electronics Center, Cornell University, and a contractor for the Office of Naval Research, discovered in 1958 that the human auditory system responds to electromagnetic energy in a portion of the radio frequency spectrum at low power densities well below that necessary for biological damage. Quote, "The human auditory system and a table radio may be one order of magnitude apart in sensitivity to radio frequency energy." Dr. Fry proposed stimulating the nervous system without the damage caused by electrodes. He wrote two papers, Microwave Auditory Effect and Applications, and Human Auditory Response to Modulated Electromagnetic Energy. Alan Fry experimented with microwaves, seeking to transmit spoken words directly into the audio cortex via a pulsed microwave analog of the speaker's sound vibration. Fry's work in this field gave rise to the so-called Fry effect, which is now more commonly referred to as microwave hearing. Fry's work had obvious implications for covert operations. He synchronized pulsed microwaves with the myocardial rhythm of a frog's heart, and the heart stopped beating. Dr. Fry had perfected the induction of heart seizures by beamed electromagnetics. He microwaved cats and found that the stimulation of the hypothalamus had a powerful effect on emotions. Fry found that human subjects exposed to 1300 megahertz to 3000 megahertz microwaves at average power densities of 0.4 to 2 milliwatts per centimeter perceived auditory sounds. The peak power densities were on the order of 200 to 300 milliwatts per centimeter, and the pulse repetition frequencies varied between 200 to 400 hertz. Fry referred to this auditory phenomenon as radio frequency sound. The sensation occurred instantaneously at average incident power densities well below that necessary for known biological damage, and appeared to originate from within or near the back of the head. Dr. Fry was reluctant to experiment on humans, but others, particularly paperclip scientists, were not. Dr. Michael Persinger, a psychologist and neuroscientist, did research on the effects of electromagnetic radiation on the brain for a Pentagon weapons project. He has worked in the field for 40 years, and funded by the Navy and reportedly by the NSA as well. Dr. Persinger perfected a means to make experimental subjects feel that they had been abducted by aliens or had an encounter with angels or God through the use of a modified motorcycle helmet equipped with solenoids to send electromagnetic pulses through the frontal lobes of the brain. Quote, "Human experience of God can be generated by a process that has nothing to do with whether God exists or not." Dr. Persinger published the paper On the Possibility of Directly Accessing Every Human Brain by Electromagnetic Induction of Fundamental Algorithms, 1995. Quote, "A process which is coupled to the narrow band of brain temperature could allow all normal human brains to be affected by a subharmonic whose frequency range at 10 hertz would vary only by 0.1 hertz. Random variations of noise within the matrices could potentially differentiate between individual brains. In other words, individuals could be identified by the specific characteristics of their brain output." He goes on further, "Identification of these sequences could also allow direct access to the most complex neurocognitive processes associated with the self, human consciousness, and the aggregate of experimental representations. in other words, episodic memory, that define the individual within the brain. In other words, a person's memory, consciousness, and sense of self can be fully accessed and modified by electromagnetic means, especially a person's personality can be completely shaped, much like the research of Dr. Ewan and Cameron, who sought to do so by more primitive means. Dr. Persinger says the brain processes can be circumvented by direct induction of this information within the brain. The basic premise is that the synthetic duplication of the neuroelectrical correlates generated by the sensors to an actual stimulus should produce identical experiences without the presence of that stimulus. What Dr. Persinger is saying is that virtually any mental state can be artificially injected into a human brain from an exterior source. The most frightening thing is that the means for doing this already exists in a fully operational form on a worldwide basis. Quote, "The power levels for these amplitudes are similar to those associated with the signals generated globally by radio and communication system. Within the last two decades, a potential has emerged which was improbable, but which is now marginally feasible. This potential is the technical capability to influence directly the major portion of the approximately 6 billion brains of the human species by generating neural information within a physical medium within which all members of the species are immersed." Unquote. Dr. Persinger's message, minus the jargon, is that the entire human race can be controlled through the use of electromagnetic influence piggybacked on television and radio networks or other technological means.
Effectively, all consciousness is due to electromagnetic patterns generated within the brain. What we do is imitate what the brain normally does and apply it experimentally.
Like, you know, where are these thoughts coming from?
Those thoughts came from the neuroscience laboratory at Laurentian University in Sudbury, Ontario.
The Strategic Defense Initiative. The Star Wars program routinely falsified research data, according to military sources at the time. Quote, "We would lose hundreds of millions of dollars in Congress if we did not perform our tests successfully. We put a beacon with a certain frequency on the target vehicle. On the interceptor, we had a receiver. The hit looked beautiful, so Congress did not ask questions." The very idea of Star Wars, an umbrella that would shield America from Soviet nuclear warheads, was itself a massive deception. No knowledgeable scientist thought for a minute such a shield was feasible, yet the Pentagon proceeded with this fraud and faked other tests in 1990 and 1991 after the Soviet threat had disappeared. Edward Teller was charged with falsifying test data on Super Excalibur, a nuclear-powered X-ray laser built by Lawrence Livermore Laboratory. The project was canceled in 1992. All the talk about death rays and charged particle beams was little more than an elaborate smokescreen designed to hide the fact that the U.S. was developing a directed energy weapon that uses a high-power microwave pulse. Livermore Labs has been a central participant in SDI since 1982, when Edward Teller, the lab's founder, suggested SDI to Reagan. The father of the H-bomb received 40,000 shares of a laser research company that later defrauded its investors. Dr. Teller tried to sell Alaska on Project Plowshare, the use of 6 thermonuclear weapons to excavate a harbor at Cape Thompson, Alaska. In 1987, Teller returned to Alaska to propose the installation of a laser-like weapon system on the north slope of Alaska. The weapon system Teller was trying to sell was classified and not openly discussed, but the presentations indicated this Star Wars weapon was in fact HAARP. In 1995, Congress killed funding for Star Wars, but HAARP continues as the ultimate SDI radio frequency radiation weapon. The Reagan administration intensified the push into electromagnetic weapons development under Project Sleeping Beauty. A scientist working for the Army's Ballistic Defense Command complained to the House Government Operations Committee that as much as half of the entire SDI budget had disappeared into classified projects.
Suddenly there was a threat to this world from some other species, from another planet, outside in the universe. We'd forget all the little local differences that we have, between our countries. Perhaps we need some outside universal threat to make us recognize this common bound. I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat.
High Frequency Active Auroral Research Project, HARP, 30 miles from Fairbanks, Alaska, is the real focus of anti-missile defense that SDI was purported to be, and much more. The public patent was titled A Method and Apparatus for Altering a Region of the Earth's Atmosphere, Ionosphere, and Magnetosphere. Dr. Bernard Eastland, a physicist who holds a patent for the fusion torch, and also holds a dozen others related to HARP that were eventually purchased by E-Systems and Raytheon. Patent number 4686605 claims the following uses: cause total disruption of all forms of communications over a very large portion of the Earth, missile or aircraft destruction, deflection or confusion, weather modification by altering solar absorption, also altering composition of the atmosphere. This patent was classified by the Navy under National Security Order in 1987, but other public patents exist for purposes of power beaming systems, artificial ionospheric mirror composed of a plasma layer, creation of artificial ionizing clouds above the Earth, defense system for discriminating between objects in space, nuclear-sized explosions without radiation. HARP is described as a research instrument for studying the ionosphere, an ionospheric heater, or IRI, of which many exist, but HARP is special. The ability to focus energy and the unprecedented amount in gigawatts, billions of watts, makes it literally millions of times more effective at heating the region about 120 miles above the Earth's surface. The atmosphere has most of its density below 30 miles altitude. The ionosphere is the very thin layer above that absorbs dangerous ultraviolet radiation and makes life possible on Earth. There is very little mixing normally between the two layers, but disturbances in the ionosphere translate to changes in weather, such as normally occurring sunspots and the solar wind. The main idea behind HARP is the ability to direct electrons along the naturally occurring magnetic field lines of the Earth and accelerate them to near the speed of light to form a protective shell of highly excited particles that not only block communications worldwide, but destroy missiles in their trajectory as they descend from space. The effects can be localized by punching a hole through the ionosphere to superheat an area 30 kilometers in diameter into a plasma shield. Any missile or aircraft would be destroyed that tried to fly through the plasma, which is the fourth state of matter. A hole in the ionosphere above an enemy country could kill by allowing solar radiation to strike the surface unhindered. Weather modification could also be used as an instrument of warfare by manipulating the electrojet and the jet streams that dictate climate. The publicly stated aim is C3, Command, Communication, and Control. The margin of victory in war is to block or intercept enemy communications and to secure your own. The signals in the ELF extremely low frequency range can be generated by HARP and heard anywhere in the world, and are used for earth-penetrating tomography, basically finding enemy submarines and underground bases. Dr. Richard Williams says the high-energy experiments will generate the equivalent of the output of 10 to 100 large power-generating stations, and that, quote, tests of these kinds could cause irreversible damage. According to Dr. Elizabeth Rauscher, quote, the ionosphere is prone to catalytic reactions, so if a small part is changed, a major change in the ionosphere can happen. HARP documents admit that a thousandfold greater amounts of energy can be released in the ionosphere than injected. Stanford University experiments beaming radio waves into the magnetosphere detected the signals halfway around the world. Some were amplified 1,000 times. David Yarrow states, quote, Earth's axial spin means that a burst lasting more than a few minutes will slice through the ionosphere like a microwave knife, producing not a hole, but a long tear, an incision. HARP documents describe intentionally trying to get a runaway effect in the ionosphere. Quote, the instabilities commonly studied are approaching their maximum radio frequency energy dissipative capacity, beyond which the plasma process will run away until the next limiting factor is reached. The first atomic weapons testing was done without knowing if the chain reaction would stop or keep going. Dr. Oppenheimer admitted years later that, quote, the government knew that the scientists didn't know. The decision to pulse several gigawatts of energy into the ionosphere could cross a threshold. Walter Richmond wrote of an account of such an event in a book entitled The Lost Millennium. The event began with a solar tap, a planetary short circuit. Quote, the surge of power became an avalanche. At the pole in the vertical plane of the Earth's magnetic field, where the winds of magnetism would not rise to blow it out, 1 trillion watt-seconds of energy unleashed their fury on the polar cap in the first flash. Even as it discharged, the ionosphere was recharged from the solar furnace. The first flash became a mighty roar that poured an increased and now steady stream of energy through the now stabilized short circuit. Kilocubit after square kilocubit of frozen wasteland boiled. Watt after watt of ever-increasing avalanched energy lit the polar cap with a glare that had never before been seen. Earth's an electrical motor. When the motor began to run wild, it would increase its rotational speed. Eventually, the Earth would explode from increased centrifugal stress. The HARP project manager describes the experiment of Earth-penetrating capability using frequencies of 10 to 20 Hertz pulses per second, or maybe 1 Hertz, 1 cycle per second type waves. This range of frequencies are the same dominant frequencies within which the human brain normally operates. The military, particularly the Navy and Air Force, have extensive research on the negative effects of extremely low-frequency radiation. These effects have been well documented, but the government easily deflects public concern by playing down the effects and minimizing the risks. This is the same method used for other military systems, including nuclear weapons tests, LSD experiments, and radiation experiments, all carried out on unknowing subjects under the guise of national security. The environmental impact statement has been falsified as to the true nature of the weapon system, its capabilities, and its possible fallout.